on the arithmetic properties of Fibonacci numbers.
Thank you very much. Unlike the guys before me, I have a mic, so you will listen, you will hear me. So I'm happy to be here and to tell you about Fibonacci numbers, and I thank the organizers of this competition to invite me. And I hope you guys had fun and solved all the problems. I'm confined to some little space here, so I cannot walk that way. But I will stay here. So let's talk about Fibonacci numbers. I'm sure most of you know what they are. They first appear in a book that Leonardo from Pisa wrote in 1202. It's called Liber Abaci. Liber Abaci is a fascinating book. It's a pretty big book. And in this book, not only it's about this sequence, it's about how to convert the arithmetic that was done at that time in Europe in Roman numerals, how to convert it to Arabic numerals. So he explains how to do the multiplication and the addition and the subtraction, pretty much all the rules that we learn about today, they are in this book. And this book also contains things about currency exchange, how to change some currency from Byzantine coins to European coins. And it contains riddles about five men that brought one horse. And it contains things about perfect numbers. And it contains this sequence in the context of how some population of couples of rabbits will multiply, assuming that every year every couple gives rise to a new couple, and then that new couple starts giving rise to babies, not in the first month, but only starting with the second month on. And that is the recurrence. So it starts with one. After 1 month, is still the same one. I mean, there's two babies, but they don't yet have successors. And then it's 1 plus 1, which is 2, and then 3, 5, and so on. So this one is the sequence of Fibonacci. And I'm sure most of you have seen it. I hope some of the things that I'm going to present here, you haven't seen it. It's a lot about problems concerning these numbers. And you guys are problem solvers. So I'll show you some problems that have been solved, maybe hint to some others that haven't yet been solved. So first of all, we would like to know a formula of the nth Fibonacci number without having to list all the previous ones. So I don't want to have to compute the first 999 numbers to find out what the 1000th number is. I would like to have a formula that I can give to n the value 1000 and put it in there and get my number. And that's the formula. So you take the what's called the golden section, 1 plus root 5 over 2, and its conjugate. They are the roots of this equation. And then simply the nth Fibonacci number. I like to write it under this symmetric formula, alpha to the n minus beta to the n over alpha minus beta. Because a little bit it looks like x to the power n minus y to the power n over x minus y. And it is that if x and y are given those two values. This is sometimes called the Binet formula. And I'm sure most of you know how to prove it, but here's a little proof. We check it for n equals 0 and 1. You assume it's true. You make the exponent n equals 0. These two numbers are 1. You subtract them, you get the number 0. Then you put n equal 1. These two exponents are 1. So the top is the same as the bottom. You get the number 1. Now you write alpha and beta. What do alpha and beta do? They satisfy this equation. So in particular, alpha squared is alpha plus 1. Beta squared is beta plus 1. You can multiply both sides with the nth power. You can multiply with any scalar. It's like little operations you do in, let's say, linear algebra. You construct linear combinations of things. And then you sum up the right-hand sides, and you get that this expression is the sum of the previous two expressions. So it follows like the Fibonacci rule. At each step, I get the sum of the previous two. So if this is already true for some constant C and D, which were 1 over alpha minus beta and minus 1 over alpha minus beta, where n equals 0 and 1, then I can use induction, and I can get it for every n. So this is one way to go about it. There's many other ways to go about it. Let me tell you about Lucas numbers. Lucas numbers come from this mathematician, Edouard Lucas, which lived in the 1800s. They form what's called a companion sequence. It follows the same rule, except that the zeroth term is 2 and the first term is 1. So it starts 2 and 1, and then the sum is 3. 1 plus 3 is 4. 3 plus 4 is 7. It goes on like this. In the same way as the Fibonacci numbers had some formula, which was this one, they were expressible in some way in terms of the nth powers of the number alpha and beta. The same thing is true for this guy. And now that I've showed you the proof, you can just verify it. You make n equals 0 here, you get alpha to the 0 plus beta to the 0. It's 1 plus 1, which is this 2 in here. You make n equal 1, you get the sum alpha plus beta, which is this 1 in there. And the same proof shows that now, if we have already correctly identified 2 and 1, then from now on every term is going to be the sum of the next 2. Well, there's many relations among them. For example, the 2nth Fibonacci number is the product between the nth Fibonacci number and the nth Lucas number. The nth Lucas number square minus 5 times the nth Fibonacci number square, it's plus minus 4. Edouard Lucas wrote a paper in 1870. I'm not going to show you the contents of his paper. It's a big paper, very nice paper. Where basically his thesis was that these numbers, they are a bit like the sine and the cosine. Where the Fibonacci numbers are like the sine and the Lucas numbers are like cosine. Every trigonometric formula you know involving sine and cosine is going to have a translation in here. So this one is cosine squared plus sine squared equal 1. That one is sine of 2x equal twice sine x cosine x. For example, sine of x plus y equals sine x cosine y plus sine y cosine x translates into that, I believe, the twice Fibonacci number of index n plus m equal Fibonacci number index n times Lucas number index m plus Fibonacci number index m times Lucas number index n. So if you know that these formulas exist, they are not hard to prove. The thing is, usually it's to guess them. For example, let's prove that Fibonacci number 2n equals Fibonacci number n times Lucas number n. You just write down the Binet formula. You factor the top, which is the difference of two squares. It's alpha to the n square minus beta to the n square. Here is the difference and here is the sum. And here we identify Fibonacci number and there we identify Lucas number. The same for this expression being plus minus 4. You replace this expression by alpha to the n plus beta to the n, and you express this expression by alpha to the n minus beta to the n over alpha minus beta. So this square is that square. And I have to use some things. For example, alpha minus beta is root 5, so it's square, it's 5, so this expression becomes 1. So I can ignore it on the next line. Here I expand the squares. When I expand the square, I get twice a mixed term in here and minus twice another mixed term in there, but they come with opposite sign. Everything else goes away. And the product alpha beta is negative 1, and that's how you get it. So in general, what this kind of theory shows is that once you've guessed some formula, it's very, very easy to prove it. Actually, once you've guessed that some formula is true, you don't even have to prove it. There's a theorem that says that if some formula involving Fibonacci and Lucas numbers that involves only some polynomial of various variables and degrees and so on, you give me the polynomial and you tell me that that formula is true, and I will look at that polynomial and I'll make some mental calculation, and I will know that if I check it for so many values and it's true, then it will be true always. That's some meta theorem. So if you see, for example, for this kind of expression, ln square minus 5x square minus 4 times minus 1 to the n equals 0. The general theorem will say that if it's true for n equals 0, 1, and 2, it's always true. All right, here's a challenge for you. How many n's do I have to verify this to conclude that it's true? I didn't tell you what the theorem is, and I don't expect an answer now. You can take it home and think about it. Here's another formula. The Fibonacci index at power m times n. Minus fn plus 1 to the m plus fn minus 1 to the m is always divisible by the cube of fn. So those things are true. They are not so easy to prove as the previous ones, but still they are exercises. You can find them. If you like problems with Fibonacci numbers, there is a journal called the Fibonacci Quarterly. There is problem section. You can go in there and you can look at the problems. That's one random problem I got from there a few years back. Actually, this one is not such a silly problem. It's actually the solution of it. It's proving that somehow these vectors, if you look at those vectors, they form some sort of a box in the five-dimensional space with the property that any two of the vectors are orthonormal, orthogonal, and they all have the length, the square root of this. So if I take the square of that, then I get the fifth power of that. I get a volume of some five-dimensional box, which is a parallelepiped. All right, let me tell you about divisibility. They obey this nice formula that the greatest common divisor between two Fibonacci numbers is the same as the Fibonacci number in the greatest common divisor of the EDC. So somehow the GCD commutes over those Fibonacci numbers. It's not so hard to prove it. Let's attempt a proof here. Suppose that A is a divisor of B. So let's try to prove, for example, that this side divides that side. Of course, this index is a divisor of both indices, so it's enough to prove that if some number divides some other number, then the Fibonacci number of that smaller index divides the Fibonacci number of the bigger index. So the way I do it, I write f sub b, I simplify the roots 5, I get alpha to the ac minus beta to the ac. I treat this as an expression x to the c minus y to the c in x being alpha to the a and y being beta to the a. And I apply some formula, I get some number. This number is an ugly number. It contains roots 5 inside. So in order to say that it's an integer, I should appeal a little bit to some mathematics. One of the ways in which you can do it, if you know what an algebraic integer is, you can say this is an algebraic integer. An algebraic integer is a root of a monic polynomial with integer coefficient, like the golden section and its conjugate. Algebraic integers have the interesting property that they form a ring. So I can add them and I can multiply them and I still get algebraic integers. So this guy is an algebraic integer. This guy is a rational number. There's a theorem that says the only algebraic integers that are rational numbers are integers. All these things are theorems. All these theorems are illustrated, for example, in here. If you don't know that, but you still know something else, for example, there's something called the fundamental theorem of symmetric polynomial. So suppose that you see an expression in some variable that's symmetric in the sense that the value of the expression doesn't change no matter how I shuffle these variables around. Then the theorem says that you can express this as a polynomial in the fundamental symmetric polynomials, which are the sum of any two products, the sum of any three products, and so on, up to the product of all of them. This is obviously symmetric in alpha and beta. It's only two variables, so I can express it as a polynomial in the sum, but I know that the sum is 1, and the product, and I know that the product is minus 1. And I can express it in such a way that, of course, I don't go outside the ring of where my expression was defined. These ones were, was an expression with integer coefficients, so this representation of that as a polynomial in this and that will also have integer coefficients, and in particular will be an integer. Okay, so I have one way. How do I go the other way? I apply the sinus of alpha A plus B formula. Here I have Fibonacci number of some sum. It's equal up to this factor of 2. It's equal to Fibonacci number of a piece of the sum times the Lucas number plus the Lucas number of the piece times the Fibonacci of the other piece. So sum between n and m minus n, it's equal to m. Let's suppose, just for the sake of the argument, sometimes it's enough to see an argument that's not 100% complete to understand why it works. And then you just look at the little differences that appear in some strange cases and you fix it. So for example, let's fix it and say one of the numbers is odd, just because the solution is easier that way. So if I have two numbers which are odd, then of course their GCD is also going to be odd. Suppose that the GCD is D. Suppose that it divides this number, and it divides that number, therefore it will divide this number, correct? But this number is a product of two guys, so I have D divides this. I would like to say that D divides the second one, but for that I want to know that D is co-prime to the first one. So how do I do that? Well, I go into the sine cosine formula, ln square minus 5 fn square co plus minus 4, and I say, my D is odd, it divides in this side. Therefore, it can't possibly catch something over here, because if it does, then that piece, together with that piece, should divide the number 4. But I know that D is odd, and that doesn't work. So therefore, this big D is co-prime to the first guy, so it divides the second guy. So now you're a problem solver. Once you see this, then you say, I got you. What do you do? Start with number m bigger than n. It divides fm and fn, and therefore it divides their difference. Therefore, I take the difference of m minus n with n again, and I take it again, and it keeps on dividing it by the same argument. And at the end, I can't take the difference anymore, because I just got to a number that's too short. What is that? That's the division with the remainder. So if I subtract from n sufficiently many multiples of n, I get to something that I can't do it anymore, because it's a remainder. So it divided over here, it divided over here, and it divided f of this. Now you see the first line, you do your algorithm. And you change mn to nr1, it divides f of this, it divides f of that, therefore it divides f of that, and you keep on going that way, until you get the last non-zero remainder. And what is that? The Euclidean algorithm says that the last non-zero remainder is exactly the greatest common divisor of the numbers m and the numbers n. So what did I do? I started with the greatest common divisor of these two numbers, and I got to the conclusion that it divides f of the greatest common divisor of the indices. I did make this little extra assumption that at least one of them was odd. But the proof goes the same if both of them are even. There, the observation is that if both of them are even, you do a quick calculation in your head with the indices, then both indices have to be multiples of 3. And furthermore, in that case, both the Lucas numbers are also even. So that saves you, because then you start with this is even, this is even, but the Lucas numbers are also even. Therefore, this 2D divides that, 2D divides that. Therefore, 2D divides this. So 2D divides that. Then you prove that 2 exactly divides ln. Therefore, D has to divide that. And you keep on going in that way. So the proof is really the same. Now there's an analog of Fermat's little theorem for Fibonacci numbers. What would be Fermat's little theorem? It's a to the p minus 1, it's congruent to 1 modulo p, correct? So we go over here in this formula. Suppose, for example, that a, alpha, and beta are honest integers, which they aren't, but let's suppose that they are. And let's take a prime. And let's take n to be p minus 1. Then a to the power p minus 1 should be 1 mod p. B to the power p minus 1 should be 1 mod p. So when I subtract them, I get the number 0. Assuming that p doesn't cancel with whatever it's in the bottom, I should get that f sub p minus 1 is a multiple of p. This is assuming alpha and beta were honest integers, which they are not. However, there is something still true about it. If you take p to be a prime, then p divides f of p if p equals 5. That's not really a theorem. The statement of a theorem would be that it should cover infinitely many cases. P equals 5 is not a theorem because it doesn't cover infinitely many cases. Unless you formulate your notion of p being a prime by saying if p divides a times b, then p divides a or p divides b, then of course p equals 5 becomes a theorem. But these are the more interesting. So if p gives remainder 1 or 4 mod 5, then p divides f sub p minus 1. And if p gives remainder 2 or 3 modulo 5, then p divides f sub p plus 1. So this looks a little bit like a Fermat's little theorem. Let me give you the proof of it. Let me give you the easy proof. The easiest proof is that 5 divides f of 5. But that is too easy, because f of 5 is equal to 5. Let me give you the other proof, the proof that's a little bit harder. Suppose that p is 1 or 4 mod 5. This means that p looks like a square modulo 5, because 1 is the square of 1 and 4 is the square of 2. Well, there is a theorem that's called quadratic reciprocity, which in this case says that if p looks like a square mod 5, then 5 looks like a square mod p. What that means? That means that 5 is actually a square. For example, take p equal 11. 5 is a square because 5 is congruent to 16, and that's 4 squared. Because of that, if you look at this quadratic equation, x squared minus x minus 1, this becomes x minus 8 times x minus 4 modulo 11. So alpha and beta are 8 and 4. As far as p equal 11, this is who alpha and beta are. It doesn't know anything else. You're not going to know which one is which, of course. You can't say alpha is 8 or alpha is 4. Which one of them is it? But you know that them as two roots are the pair 8, 4. So then in some sense, the nth Fibonacci number really looks like 8 to the n minus 4 to the n divided by 8 minus 4. This is how 11 knows how to calculate it, because he doesn't have any other way. So because of that, because of the Onnes-Fermat-Lyra theorem, then alpha to the p minus 1 minus beta to the p minus 1, if p is odd, so doesn't divide 8 or 4, becomes 1 minus 1, it's 0 for this p equal to 11, and alpha minus beta square equal to 5, so alpha minus beta is, I guess in this case would be 4, if you make the decision this to be true, and if they are switched is minus 4, so alpha minus beta is invertible mod p. Oh, here's a typo, therefore f sub p minus 1 should be 0 mod. So this is that. Now, I haven't written down the proof of this. That uses a little bit of Galois theory. In the case when p is not 1 or 4 modulo 5, then this polynomial remains irreducible. So the prime, let's say p equals 13, it's not going to know what are its roots. However, there is something called the Frobenius. What the Frobenius is, if you have a field of characteristic p, the Frobenius sends x to the power x to the p. This is an automorphism, so it commutes with the sum, because x plus y to the p is the same as x to the p plus y to the p in characteristic p. So what the Frobenius is going to do in this particular case, the Frobenius just fixes it, fixes the number. This is what Fermat's Little Theorem says, I to the p equal a. In quadratic cases, what the Frobenius does, it sends one root to the other root. So alpha to the p is going to go to beta, and beta to the p is going to go to alpha. But if alpha to the p goes to beta, where does alpha plus to the p plus 1 go? Goes to alpha times beta, and that's negative 1. That already lives in the integer. So alpha to the p plus 1 becomes negative 1, and now I can replace alpha by beta. So then I get alpha to the p plus 1 is negative 1. Beta to the p plus 1 is also negative 1. When I subtract them, I get 0. And this is why, if p is 2 or 3 mod 5, then p divides f sub p plus 1. So it's really the same as Fermat's little theorem, just by chasing out where does a to the p go, modulo p. Let me tell you the notion of a primitive prime. For each prime number p, let z sub p be the smallest positive integer k, such that p divides f sub k. This number is called the order of appearance. Sometimes people call it the order of apparition. But that is wrong. Apparition exists in English, but it means something else. It means a ghost. If you sleep in an abandoned house and you wake up, there's no... Well, that's an apparition. This is an appearance. But it was translated because it was translated from French, which was l'ordre d'apparition. This is why it was translated sometimes like that. It has the following properties. It behaves like the order of an element in a finite group. Let's say, what is the order of the element A in a group G? Is the smallest integer K, such that the element to power K becomes 1. What is one of the important properties? Is that if that element to some number becomes 1, then the order divides that number. That's the same property here. If F sub N is a multiple of the number P, then N is a multiple of this order of appearance. Z sub 5 equal to 5. And if P is not 5, then the order of appearance either becomes p minus 1, divides p minus 1, or it divides p plus 1. And this part is a consequence of that part, and of the previous theorem, because the previous theorem says that p divides f sub p minus 1, and the first part says that if p divides f sub n, like in the case of n is equal to p minus 1, if p was 1 or 4 mod 5, then zp has to divide the index, which is p minus 1. The prime factor of Fn is called primitive. If it divides Fn, of course, it has to be a prime factor there. But it has not been a prime factor before. For example, f sub 12 does not have primitive prime. If you look at the factorization of f sub 12, which is 144, it's only built up of 2s and 3s. And 2 already was the third Fibonacci number, and 3 was already the fourth Fibonacci number. So I go to f sub 12 and I don't find a new prime. If I go to f sub 6, which is the number 8, also I don't have a new prime, because 8 is only divisible by 2 as primes. Well, Carmichael proved a fantastic theorem in 1913. He proved a more general theorem than this, but in particular, it proved that if n is bigger than 12, then f sub n has a primitive prime factor. So 12 is the worst, let's say, largest exception. So if I go farther and I keep on factoring those Fibonacci numbers, at step n, I will always find the prime factor of it, which I have not seen before. I have not seen in the factorizations of the previous one. If p is primitive for fn, then certainly z sub p is equal to n, by the very definition. Because z sub p is the smallest index where p divides. If p divides fn, it hasn't divided before, then certainly n is that smallest index. And if we look here, then this number n would divide either p minus 1 or p plus 1. So immediately we get for free that whenever f sub n has a primitive prime factor, which is the case of all n larger than 12, that prime is large, is at least n minus 1. In 1965, Paul Erdős conjectured that we should do much better than that. If I look at the largest prime factor of the nth Fibonacci number, I already know that it's at least n minus 1. So if I divide by n, I get some sequence, and the limit of this sequence is greater or equal to 1. Because I know that, well, even, yes, because p of f sub n is at least n minus 1, so the limit is at least 1. His conjecture was that, in fact, if I look at the limit, this has a limit, then the limit should be infinity. And this was proved so not long ago. It was proved so by Stewart in 2013. He actually proved the following theorem, that the largest prime factor of n is bigger than n times some function that tends to infinity with n. That function that tends to infinity with n is n to the exponent 1 over 1 over double log n. It takes a little while to understand that that function tends to infinity. You have to think of n as being e to the power log of n. And then if I divide by this exponent, then I have log of n divided by 104, which of course doesn't matter in the long run, but it's log log n. So I have something of the form log x over log log x, and that tends to infinity because I have fewer logs on the top than on the bottom. He proved that this is true for all n sufficiently large, and he didn't compute what that means. There is still a conjecture of Schintzel to find all the n such that the largest prime factor of n of 2 to the n minus 1 is at most 2n, I think n equal 23 or something like that has that. Okay, so let me talk about Andrei Schintzel's results. He wrote some papers, he wrote two or three papers in 1963 and another paper in 1968, all of them in Acta Arithmetica, a very good journal in Poland for number theory. He proved important results about members of a more general family of sequences called Yukawa-Lemmer sequences. So what he was interested in, for the particular problem of the Fibonacci sequence, although he was working with more general sequences, it's okay, fine, we know it has primitive divisors, if n is at least 12. When can we say that it has at least 2 primitive prime factors, or at least 3 primitive prime factors, or at least 4, and has some technical condition? And of course, his theorem is not for the Fibonacci sequence. His theorem is a very general theorem, but if you look in it and you extract what you need, there is what Schintzel proved. Suppose that n is a multiple of 10, so it's 10 times some odd number, that odd number is at least 5, then Schintzel's theorem says that fn has at least 2 primitive prime factors. So when I prepared this lecture, I went to Mathematica, I took the first examples. 10 times an odd number, which is at least 5. Which ones are they? 50 and 70. So I said, okay, this is the factorization of f sub 50. Now we only have to look at f sub m, where m is a divisor of 50, such that it's a maximal divisor of 50. with respect to the divisibility relation, not with respect to the order relation. So a maximal divisor, meaning there is no other divisor of 50, which is a multiple of that number. So I looked at 10 and 25. These ones are the maximal divisors. 10 catches 5 and 11. 25 catches 5 squared and 3001. So there is these two numbers left. You see, 1 on 1 and 151 are both primitive for f sub 50. The same for f sub 70. Now f sub 70, how many maximal divisors does it have? 70, it has maximal divisors. How do I calculate maximal divisor? I divide it by 1 prime at a time. So if I divide it by the prime 5, I get 14. If I divide by the prime 2, I get 35. And if I divide by the prime 10, by the prime 7, I get 10, which is already written here. So this 5 and 11 are occupied. This 13 and 29 are occupied over here. 5, 13, and this huge number is there. So here there's two new ones, 71 and 911. That's a problem for you. Find all n such that the largest prime factor of f of n is at most 10n. That's a genuine problem. I don't know how to do it. I asked Stuart. Stuart said, well, my argument is effective. I said, sure, then why don't you do this? And he didn't do it. But maybe he was lazy. So let me tell you about now polynomial Diophantine equations. There are many papers in the literature that look at the following question. Take some polynomial, which is of degree at least 2, and try to decide what's about the number of solutions of this equation, f sub n equal f of n. Why is it of degree at least 2? A degree at least 1 is a bit less interesting. Why is it less interesting? Because a degree 1 polynomial of integers is just an arithmetic progression. So the polynomial a of x plus b really means numbers which are congruent to b modulo a. And for them, the problem is not hard. I take the Fibonacci sequence, I reduce it mod a. There's a general theory that it's periodic and so on. So I can see if I hit a b. And if I hit a b once, I'll hit it infinitely many times because it's periodic. And that's it. And that's all the solutions. But how about if I put here squares and other things? So lots of people worked on that. Squares were very attractive. For example, f of 0 is 0. F of 1 and f of 2 are both 1. F of 12, which we already saw, it's 144. All these guys are squares. They proved in 1964 in an independent way. This is a problem from the American Math Monthly, and this is a genuine publication. They showed that the only integer solutions of this equation are just those ones. But then other people thought about other polynomials. How about the cubes? 0 is there, it's a cube. 1 is there, it's a cube. 8 is there because it's the sixth member, it's a cube. And that's all they are. There's no more cubes. And in 1975, a mathematician from Canada called Hugh Williams said, let's try x squared plus 1. And he found all of them. Usually these solutions are kind of small. So if you notice some example, maybe 2 squared plus 1, which is 5, maybe it's the largest one. In 1981, Neville Robbins found all the integer solutions to Fn being the cube plus minus 1. And to Fn being a square minus 1. This is a nice one. Not only that it has the triangular numbers are popular, but also that it has a relatively large number of solutions compared to the other one. So you get 0 is in there, 1 is in there, make x equal to 1. F2 is the same. F4 is 2. F4 is 3, so I guess it's 2 times 3 over 2. F sub 8. How much is f sub 8? That's 21. I guess that's 6 times 7 over 2. And f sub 10, that's 55. That's 10 times 11 over 2. So it has a relatively large number of solutions. And also this one. Also this one. I was reading those papers when I was, a little bit older than you are now. But I liked them. They were, a lot of them were done in elementary ways. And I so much wanted to find some polynomial that nobody else has worked on and that those methods were working. And I worked very hard, found this polynomial for which the method worked. So I got some points there. I found the largest x with the prop that f sub n is x squared plus x plus 2. In 2002, Laszlo Szalai found this, the largest solution to that. Well, the game in some sense now, with the fact that the computers are getting so clever and so fast, and we have very nice computer programs like Magma and so on. All these things that people were working with in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, they are, in some sense, you ask a computer and it will do it immediately for you. And here is the reason why. Let's go back to the sine and cosine equation. Suppose that f sub n is some polynomial, and you want to detect that. Then put f sub n equal that polynomial, and there you get this equation. Now, this polynomial has degree 4 or more. So you get an equation of the type y square equal g of x, where g has degree 3 or more. Now there's a theorem of Ziegler that says the following. Take the equation y square equal g of x, no matter who g is, with the integer or rational coefficient. But suppose that g has at least 3 roots that have odd multiplicity. In particular, suppose that g has at least 3 simple roots. Then the equation y square equals g of x has only finitely many integer solutions. And there's an algorithm to compute all of them, and this algorithm has been implemented in Magma and other things. So right now you only give it g of x and it gives you the solution. So in that sense, the problem is not so interesting now, because now you can just take f of x to be your polynomial, like triangular numbers or whatever. It's some polynomial of degree 4. You see if it has double roots. You don't even need a computer for that. You just compute its derivative and you try to eliminate x, see if it has some, or you just do Horner scheme, divide some polynomial by its derivative to find out if there is a double root in there. And that's it. So, actually, let me give you an example first. You would think that maybe whatever polynomial I give you for degree at least 2, there will be only finitely many solutions. And I will say, no, that is not true. And why is it not true? Because f of n is like the sine. So the sinus of 3x is a polynomial of degree 3 in the sinus of x. It's 4 sine cube of x minus 3 sine of x. Sinus of 5x is a polynomial of degree 5 in sinus of x. And the first coefficient is 16 sinus of, so I know the first one. Sinus of kx, it's 2 to the power k minus 1 sine x to the k, blah, 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 blah. And, but I told you that the Fibonacci numbers are like the sinus problem. So just take some odd number, let's say number 3, get alpha to the 3m minus beta to the 3m. This one is alpha to the m minus beta to the m times some quadratic factor. This quadratic factor, you can rearrange it. So you just add another alpha or beta to the m, or subtract twice from here. You get alpha to the m minus beta to the m everything square. That's 5 times fn square. And for example, if m is odd, then the sign of this guy is negative 1 minus 3, and there you get it. So the polynomial f sub n equal x times 5x square minus 3 has the property that this equation has infinitely many solutions. You can actually characterize it. Now, this was done in a paper by István Nemes and Attila Péter. They actually characterized all Fibonacci numbers with the property that the equation f sub n equal f of x with f of degree at least 2 is infinitely many solutions. And these polynomials are related to the Chebyshev polynomials, because this polynomial that I gave you about sinus of 3x in terms of sinus of x and sinus of 5x in terms of the sinus of x and so on, they are related to the Chebyshev polynomials. And in some sense, it's about the same question. If you think about it, it comes from the Ziegler theorem. You want to say y squared equals some polynomial of degree at least 3, and this has infinitely many solutions. So that polynomial can't have too many simple roots. Well, think of the equation x squared plus y squared equals 1. And suppose that you have some polynomial solutions in x and y versus a third variable t. Then these ones are exactly related to Chebyshev polynomials, and these ones, in some sense, exactly are the failures of Ziegler's theorem. Because for those ones, y squared, which is 1 minus x squared, here you have a square, and in the other side, you have some polynomial of a large degree, and still you have infinite many solutions. All right. Now let me show you more silly things now. Let's look at Fibonacci numbers and factorials. In 1999, I showed that if I try to represent a Fibonacci number as a product of a bunch of factorials, then I don't have too many solutions. There is the odd solution f sub 12, which is 3 factorial times 4 factorial. It can also be written in this way. And that's the largest solution. Then with a mathematician from the United States, George Grossman, we show that if you give me any number k which is fixed, instead of writing it as product, I want to write it with sums, then this has also only finitely many positive integer solution. When k is equal to 2, the largest one is again 144. 144 is a stubborn Fibonacci number. Somehow, whatever question you ask, it becomes one of the answers. Although the questions are completely unrelated, but somehow, this is Richard Guy says about this, that this is a manifestation of the law of small numbers. The law of small numbers says there are too few small numbers, therefore some of them will coincide. So if you ask many questions whose solutions are small numbers, then of course the same small number will appear as some answer to a lot of them. How about solving this one? If I impose, for example, that all these numbers are distinct, and of course if I let them to be equal to each other or to be equal even to with 1, then I can represent any number as a sum of factorials. Just write it there, 1 factorial plus 1 factorial plus 1 factorial and so on. But let's not assume those trivial things. Let's write numbers which are sums of factorials which are distinct, but don't bound the number of them. Let them be whatever they want. You get some set of numbers. Question, does it contain finitely or infinitely many Fibonacci numbers, this set? I don't know the answer to that. Oh. Well, that's a pretty good high-resolution picture. In 2004, together with my friend Pante, we wrote a paper that has no word in the title. This is the title of our paper. What that title means is that this is the largest instance in which a product of a bunch of Fibonacci numbers is equal to a product of factorials. I don't assume that the factorials are distinct. I can take the factorials to be equal, some of them to each other. However, I have to assume that something is distinct in either one side or the other side. Because if I allow equal things both here and there, then I get infinitely many solutions. It's like in a group. If I already have some word, the product of some guys equal to the product of some other guys, then I can take powers of that. If I don't have any sort of restriction that things should be different, then I'll certainly get infinitely many solutions. All right. So let me give you a proof of that. Suppose that f of n is a product of factorials. Suppose that n is at least 12. I use Carmichael's primitive divisor theorem. There's a prime factor of f of n which is primitive. Since its primitive is at least as large as n minus 1, it sits in this side. One of these factorials in here has to catch him. So the largest factorial has to be at least n minus 1. Now do Stirling's formula or whatever you want, f sub n is a product of these factorials, which is at least n minus 1 factorial. N minus 1 factorial is at least n minus 1 over 2 to the power n minus 1, if n is at least 12. However, the nth Fibonacci number is at most the golden section to n minus 1, that you can prove easily from the Binet formula. So combining those inequalities, you get a contradiction for n bigger than 12. So you see, I'm only showing you the trivial proofs. I'm not showing you the hard proofs. Representing factorials in an integer base. So I took a factorial and I wrote it as a sum in some base, whatever base you want. You're going to get some digit. And I asked myself, what is the complexity of that representation? So is it true that the number of non-zero digits, or let's say, is it true that the sum of the digits that you get in that way goes to infinity with n? And I proved the proof is very easy. I proved that, yes, it's true. In fact, the sum of the digits of n factorial in any base is at least as large as a constant times the log of n. Which is probably not, it's certainly not a good result. The good result should be that n factorial should look kind of random in any base, except for the fact that it ends with a bunch of zeros. Because of course, n factorial is going to be divisible with a large power of that base. Because it's divisible with a large power of that base, when I write it in that base, it's going to have a lot of zeros at the end. But after you forget those zeros at the end, what's going to happen in the middle? The conjecture should be that maybe in the middle it should happen like a random number. Maybe it has about 1/9 of the digits, or 1/10 of the digits are ones and 1/10 of the digits are twos and so on. So maybe its sum is going to be roughly proportional to the logarithm of the number. And the logarithm of n factorial is about n log n, right? Because n factorial is like n over e to the power n. Well, anyway, I published this paper. The only improvement was done last year or 2 years ago by a young mathematician from Italy. He added another triple log of n in this side. He showed that the sum of the digits of n factorial in base b is at least as large as a constant log n times triple log n. The proof is based on the same idea. What is the idea? The idea is that n factorial is divisible by b minus 1, b squared minus 1, b cubed minus 1, and so on. So try to take a number in base 10, which is divisible with 9, with 99, with 999, with 900, 9099, and so on for a while. And the question is, can you do it with a number that has few non-zero digits, like constant times the power of 10 plus another constant, where constants are between 1 and 9? And you will realize right away that's not possible. So you have to have more and more and more digits. So this is pretty much the idea that's there. All these numbers are, if all these numbers are small enough so they are up to n, they will all divide n factorial. And how big is m such that b to the m minus 1 is at most n? Well, put the 1 in the other side and take the log. So you get m can go up to about a constant times log n. And then you switch that around, and that's how you get the result. If you want to throw in another triple log of n, then you have to be a little bit more clever. And actually, Carlo, this is what he did. He went with b to the m minus 1 above n. And he used the cyclotomic decomposition. That x to the n minus 1 is a product of cyclotomic polynomial. Each cyclotomic polynomial is of degree 5n. And if you sit in some n where the prop that n is composed of a lot of very, very small primes, then 5n is going to drop. So you can start, you can be with m roughly around the exponential of a constant log n, triple log n. And if you take the Euler function of that, you're still below the, let's say, the cyclotomic pieces of that are still below n, so they participate in n factorial. So in some sense, the idea is the same, except that he threw a lot more analytic number theory into the argument. Now, here's a question for you. There is a way of representing integers using Fibonacci numbers instead of bases. So for bases, what do you do? What do you do for base 10? You single out the largest power of 10 that's below my number, and you divide, and you get some quotient, which is between 1 and 9. Well, that's going to be your leading digit. Then you separate that, and then you get a smaller number, and this is how you come up with the digits, then in base 10 or in any base. Well, there is a similar way you can do it with Fibonacci numbers. You take a number n, and you look at the largest Fibonacci number that's below it, and you take that away. And then you get a smaller number. You look at the largest Fibonacci number that's smaller than that, and you take that away. And continuing it in this way, you get a representation of n as a sum of Fibonacci numbers. For example, I don't know, let's take 63. Then the largest Fibonacci number is 55. The difference is 8, that happens to be a Fibonacci number. So 63 is f sub 10 plus f sub 6. And in the same way, every n is a sum of Fibonacci numbers. And because of the greedy way in which we do it, no two indices are consecutive. Because if two of them are consecutive, it means that you weren't greedy enough, because the sum of two consecutive ones is the next one. So you failed to be greedy. This is why it appears in there. This actually has a name. It's called the Zeckendorf representation. So you can think of the number of summons in the Zeckendorf representation as some number of digits. And then you can ask the questions. Is the result I showed you before true for the factorial? Is it true that this goes to infinity with n? And I have no idea. N factorial equal a Fibonacci number, we just did that. N factorial is a sum of two Fibonacci numbers. That's a bit harder. N factorial being a sum of three Fibonacci numbers, we also did that in 2007 in the paper. This is the most interesting example. The largest factorial, which is a sum of three Fibonacci numbers, 6, 6 factorial, is f sub 15 plus f sub 11 plus f sub 8. We haven't tried with 4. We don't even know if it has a finite answer. So let me show you how we did it. Just show you some, throw some mathematics at you. Suppose that I have a solution like this. Then one proves easily by size argument, since n factorial is at most n log n or something like this, e to the n log n or n to the n, and these guys are roughly the golden section to power x, one shows that x, y, z are bounded by this. Now suppose that m is a small even number, so I'm trying to repeat the process that's in here. So I'd like to look at small f of m for small m's that divide in here. And I would like, but in order to do that, I have to write this representation in terms of f sub m. This is how it works for the bases. So by small, I mean that the Lucas number in the half of m is at most n. Then I get that both f sub m and this expression divides the factorial of m. Now I write x modulo 2m is x0 plus something, some multiple of 2m, and the same with y and the same with z. But then I don't do it modulo 2m, I can do the honest division with remainder. Or I can do the one in which the remainder doesn't live between 0 and the number, but it lives between minus a half of the number and a half of the number. So I use that one. So then I get that f sub x0 plus 2 lambda n. This is easy to prove. So, and in fact, even better, twice f sub x0 plus lambda m is congruent to this modulo f sub m over 2 cubed. And because f sub m divides n factorial, I get this solution. So now x0, y0, z0 were between minus m and m, and they satisfy this. If you do it with the bases, then you immediately get contradiction. But if you do it with Fibonacci numbers, it's not so easy. Because this congruence has several solutions. And one of the solutions that makes life very hard is the fact that when you go into negative indices with Fibonacci numbers, they are also the Fibonacci numbers, but they alternate signs. So think I start with 0, 1, 1, and I want to go to the left. What do I need to put here? That I add with 0, I get 1. I have to put 1, but then I get 1 more to the left. What do I have to put there? I have to put minus 1, because minus 1 plus 1 gives me 0. And I keep on going, and then I put 2 and minus 3 and so on. So these guys change signs. So one situation in which things are really bad, it's if this guy is a number, this guy is the next number. So f sub a plus 1, then the answer is f sub a plus 2. But suppose that this 0, this one is minus a sub a plus 2 with the correct parity. Then this guy has become 0. This doesn't happen in integer bases. And this is why the problem is hard. So we get several solutions. We get this parametric family. And then we conclude, for example, that not all x, y, and z are odd. If x, y, and z are all even, then m divides their sum. If x is even and y and z are odd, then m divides x plus 4. If x and z are both even and y is odd, then m divides these, and blah, blah, blah. So I get basically a bounded list of things of the form. I have some linear expression like m, x plus y plus z, and that's divisible by m. Now, the idea would be that, let's say, if x plus y plus z is divisible by m for all the m's, then I will conclude that x plus y plus z is divisible with a very large number. But on the other hand, the sum of it, it's at most this, and I get a contradiction for large enough m. And this is pretty much how it works. I have to use some results about analytic number theory. I take a prime, which is between 3 and 2.076 logarithm of n. Then L in that prime is at most n, so I can take m equal 2p in the above statement. So for example, this guy is a multiple of all primes up to there. Then I compute what's called the Chebyshev theta function, which is the sum of log of p's for all p's up to this number. That's something that appears in the proof of the prime number theorem. And then in this case, I get n is at most l to the power 31, which is not a very big number. But if I study all the cases, I get that n is, look at this number, n is at most 10 to the 104. And I tell you, oh, this is great. N is at most 10 to the 100, and now we only have to do their factorial. How about that? Well, you see, this is not a very easy problem. Even computationally, it's very difficult. So one has to be clever and sieve things away. So we sieve things away up to 55 million, and even computing factorials up to 55 million. It's not so easy, but you don't compute them. Usually when you test these things, you test on something. You don't compute all the factorials up to 55 million. You only test if the factorials up to 55 million are a sum of three Fibonacci numbers. Then that's a different question. You don't have to specifically spell them out. Now let's look at arithmetic functions with them. Take phi of n and sigma of n be the Euler function and the sum of divisors function. There's a famous theorem of Euler, of Gauss, which I'm sure you know about it, that the regular polygon with n sides can be constructed with the ruler and the compass if and only if the Euler function of n is the power of 2. This is how Fermat with primes come in there and powers of 2. So I asked myself, well, what if I throw in Fibonacci numbers into the question? So I take the Euler function of a Fibonacci number is a power of 2. And I found it, 34. 5, 34. 34 is 2 times 17. 17 is a Fermat number. The Euler function is 16. Now for this one, n is equal to 8. Which one is the 8th Fibonacci number? I think 21. That's 3 times 7. The sum of divisors is 4 times 8. These ones are the largest solution. There is a question about perfect numbers. So the perfect numbers are numbers n with the property that the sum of divisors of n is twice times n. I'm sure you know about them. There's a criterion due to Euler of how they look like if they are even. N has to be a power of 2 times the next power of 2 minus 1, and that next power of 2 minus 1 should be a prime. And about odd perfect numbers, we don't know anything. We don't know if they exist. We don't know that they don't exist either. But you can still restrict your attention and search for them into a smaller set. For example, let's take Fibonacci numbers. Are there perfect numbers in there? Well, they are not. And then we even, we proved together with this mathematician Nicolai, we looked at Fibonacci numbers whose Euler function is another Fibonacci number. And I got a few at the beginning. And, here's my co-author, Paul Young, impersonating one of the Blues Brothers. So I think he's a visitor at Ostrava. He came here before. So we looked at numbers with the property that the number of divisors of n divides n. There's infinitely many numbers like that. For example, take 8 times p, where p is a prime, and compute the number of divisors of that. 8 is 2 cubed, so it's 4 times 2, so it's 8. But throw Fibonacci numbers into the question. What are the Fibonacci numbers such that the number of divisors of that Fibonacci number divides that number? And actually we found a large one, which is 48. It looks like a silly question, but it's related to squares and other things. And here is how the proof would start. Suppose that f of n, for example, is odd. Then the number of its divisors is also odd. Well, what do you know about numbers whose number of divisors is odd? Exactly, they are squares. You don't even need to know a formula for the number of divisors to understand that the number of divisors of a number is odd if and only if the number is a square. Why is that? Because you group any divisor d with the divisor n over d. And that works for most numbers. Except for what? Except for the squares, there's a number that's left by himself. Because if n is the square of d, then d and n over d coincide. So you can't do this parity argument. So if you do that, you say, if this guy is odd, and the number of divisors divides it, then it's a square, but I already know the squares in the Fibonacci sequence. So I look which one of them are odd, but there are not too many. Then I say, suppose f of n is divisible by 2, but not by 4. Then the same argument shows you, well, then the Fibonacci number should be a prime times the square, so then there's variations of it. Now the Fibonacci number equal to prime times the square. What can I say about that equation? And you keep on going in that way. All right? And also you know that fn has to be even, so that prime is either 2, or it's an odd prime, but then the Fibonacci number is divisible by 4, so then you get all sorts of properties, and that's what allows you to solve this problem. Here's a mathematician, Derek Lemmer. He conjectured in 1932 that if the Euler function of n divides n minus 1, then n is a prime number. Believe it or not, it's still open. Nobody knows if that's true. Nobody has found the counterexample. What do I do? Well, of course, if you throw any problem at me, I'm going to throw Fibonacci numbers back at you. So I put Fibonacci numbers in there. And I said, what about this? Well, it turns out that the Fibonacci numbers, they do work. If the Euler function of a Fibonacci number, so if a Fibonacci number has that property, then it has to be prime. And actually, you used some results of other people. For example, Pomerans wrote a paper in 77 showing that if m is composite and 5n divides m minus 1, and m has k prime factor, then k has to be large. K to the 2 to the k has to be at least m. For me, k to the 2 to the k has to be at least fn. Since fn is at least the golden section to n minus 2, I get that k is at least as big as this ratio, if n is bigger than 1,000. Then I go to p, I reduce it, divides fn is odd. Then I reduce this equation. So I get that p divides over here. Here is a square. Here's another square. So I get that minus 1 becomes a square mod p. But therefore, I know that p is 1 mod 4. So all prime numbers in here have to be 1 mod 4. Now, if I compute phi of f of n, every time there's a prime in there, I catch the factor of p minus 1, so I catch a 2. But since my p's are actually 1 mod 4, I catch 2 2's. So I get 2, I get 4 to the power k minus 1, divides this, which divides fn minus 1. And guess what? Here I have a factorization. This is maybe similar to the fact that sinus of a minus sinus of b, what is that? 2 sinus of a minus b over 2 cosinus of a plus b over 2. Here's my trigonometric formula. That always works for Fibonacci numbers and Lucas numbers. So I get this huge power of 2 divides in this side. But then Lucas numbers are never divisible by 8. So I have to sacrifice a couple of 2s in here maybe, but all the rest is going to divide in there. Then I get 2 to a huge power divides some Fibonacci number. Now I leave this as an exercise for you, that if I have a huge power of 2 dividing some Fibonacci number, then the index is divisible by almost as huge as the power of 2. It's not really 2 to the s, but it's 3 times 2 to the s minus 2. So in any rate, I get 2 to the s is at most 4m plus 3. So for me, m is this number. So this one is 4m plus over 3. And this one is 2 to the 2s. 2 to the 2k minus 4, which is at least as big as I said here. Oh, I think maybe it should have been 2 to the 2k. 2 to the 2k minus 4 is at least as big as that. So I put them together and I get a contradiction for n is bigger than 1,000. This is an easy case. There's another case which is harder. I have a student, Miss Fay. I assigned this problem to a student. I said, do the same for Lucas numbers, and she did it. Here is Miss Fay coming back from some competition or a conference or something like that. Well, perfect powers. At the beginning of the talk, I saw some instances of Diophantine equations of this form, f sub n equal a square or f sub n equal a cube. How about for higher powers? Well, for higher powers, there's a great paper written 10 years ago by Yann Bougeot, Maurice Mignot, and Samir Sixac. It was published in a journal called Annals of Mathematics, which has the reputation of being maybe the best mathematics journal in the world. They proved that these guys are the only powers. So we know all the squares, we knew all the cubes, but the question is, what about fifth powers? What about seventh powers? What about 11th powers? Of course, as in the case of Fermat's last theorem, if you're just searching for powers, you can resume yourself to the exponent being a prime, but still there's infinitely many primes, and you have to conquer them, and that's what they did. Then I also teamed up with them and wrote some other things. For example, what about if I have a product of a bunch of Fibonacci numbers equal a perfect power times some factor? And I don't know much about the factor except that the largest prime factor is at most 541. And here I have a number p, and here I have fewer Fibonacci numbers than the index. So you can see that this one is a genuine generalization. You take m equal to 1 and b equal to 1, and it just fulfills their theorem. But it gives a little bit more flexibility. Then all these indices belong to this set. What this set means that I'm skipping 17, but all the numbers up to 16 are there, and all the numbers up to 22 are there, and then I skip a few, like 23, 25, and 28, and so on. Now, here's a fun problem. Take a product of consecutive Fibonacci numbers equal to power. Well, let me tell you why I was working on that one. Erdős and Selfridge wrote a paper, which is famous in the area, in which they proved that the product of two or more consecutive integers is never a perfect power. That's a wonderful result. Because maybe you can do it for two, it's not so hard. Maybe you can do it for three, but to prove that the product of two or more is never a perfect power, then that takes some very interesting ideas. Now this fellow, Tarlok Shuri, is a mathematician from Mumbai. He's been working with this problem for a number of years. He said, well, let's replace products of consecutive integers by products of integers in arithmetic progression. What can we say about that? Does that have infinitely many solutions or no solutions? And he could prove things, assuming the ratio had certain shapes and so on. So I visited him, and I didn't want it to get sucked into the problem he usually works with. So as a mathematician, if you visit some other mathematician, then you either have to accept what they do and work with them in their problem, or you have to suggest something that's interesting to them. And I said, let's put Fibonacci numbers in there. So he agreed. so then we looked at this. Let me give you one example, which I think is a great example. Take this equation. Take k equal to 3. Use the property that the GCD of any two Fibonacci numbers is f of the GCD of them. But the GCD between n and n plus 1 is 1. So any two Fibonacci numbers are co-prime. How about between n and n plus 2? Well, the GCD is 1 or 2, but f of 1 and f of 2 are both equal to 1. So fn and n plus 2 are also co-prime. So I have a product of three guys. Being a perfect power, any two of them are co-prime. What is the arithmetical deduction? That each one of them is a perfect power. But the largest one is the sum of the two previous ones. So I get two perfect powers of exponent m, which sum up a perfect power of exponent m. Whose last theorem is that? All right, so you see, yes, Fermat's last theorem. I'm not saying that this is what we use, but of course, in mathematics, you can use whatever you know it's true and it has been proved. This is the game we play, right? If we have already conquered a certain problem, then we use that problem to conquer the next one. So this would be one possibility to do it. All right? So let me see. Now I'm going to maybe start skipping some of them. I've already been speaking for about an hour and 15 minutes. I'll probably finish in about 5 to 10 minutes. I have a lot more things to show. But I always prepare some infinite talk and give only a finite part of it, so I have to understand where to stop. More equations with powers and consecutive Fibonacci numbers. There's two mathematicians from Hungary visited these two mathematicians from India, and here's what they came up with. Conjecture. The only quadruple of this, it's 8, 2, 4, and 3. Let me try to remember which one is the ordering of the variables. So the first exponent is 8. And then the first, this number is 4. So I'm going F1 plus F2. So I get 1 to the 8, which is 1, plus 1 to the 8, which is 1, plus 2 to the 8, which is 256. How much do I get until now? I get 258. Then in the other side, I have to skip the 3. And I have to start with the 5. And it should be to the power cube. So I start with 5 cube, which is equal to, I start with 5 square, which is equal to 25. And then I move on to the next one, which is 8 square, which is 64. Help me out. 25 plus 64 is 89. And then I go to the next one, which is 13. 13 square is 169. 169 plus 89, how much do I get? 258, which is 1 plus 1 plus 2 to the 8. Well, anyway, I have no idea how they came up with that. I assume they just searched for it in a box and it just came out. And this was proved with my student. Here is Saul Diaz Alvarado. He's from Mexico. An Aztec man. You can see his uniform. And here's Andre Duela from Croatia. All right, maybe let me skip this one, and let me skip this one, and let me skip this one, and let me skip this one. Let me show you this one. I think this is an interesting one. Here's a question about multiplicity of the Pascal triangle. Look at the Pascal triangle, which are all the binomial coefficients. Ignore the ones on the side. Ignore the next diagonal, which is n choose 1, because that's all the numbers. So let's throw those ones away. Fold it because you have a symmetry with respect to the axis. So let's throw away the right half. And then what we are left with a collection of numbers. Genuine binomial coefficient, n choose 2, n choose k for k between 2 and a half of n. Question. What is the multiplicity of that? Namely, how many times can a number repeat in this table? Maybe some number is n choose 2 and also shows up as n choose 3. Maybe some number is n choose 2 and also shows up as n choose 5. Are there finitely many numbers that would repeat or not? Well, the conjecture is that there should be finitely many numbers that repeat except for this parametric family. Isn't that a beautiful parametric family? Well, you see, once somebody shows it to you, you understand how they found it. The way they found it, they said, let's try n choose k equal n minus 1 choose k plus 1. The point is that if you try n choose k equal n minus 1 choose k plus 1, then a lot of these factorials are close together. So you can chop off n minus 1 factorial from the right out of whatever it is on the left. You get an n left. And then down you chop off k factorial from here, just get k plus 1, maybe in this side. And over there, you get n minus k or something like that. So you get some quadratic equation that involves n and k. And somehow you grouped it and these kind of formulas come up. Well, maybe this will be the last proof that I give and then I will stop. I found all the solutions to this one. So suppose that I look in a row of the Pascal triangle. I look at consecutive binomial coefficients and I try to detect a Pythagorean couple, triple. So n choose k squared equal n plus 1 choose k plus n plus 1 choose k squared equal n plus 1 choose k squared equal n choose k plus 2 squared. Was it that? Maybe it was n plus 2 choose k. Oh, yes. I have a typo here. I have this plus 1 should be down there. I was baffled by the lack of symmetry of my own equation. So n choose k squared is n choose k plus 1 squared plus n choose k plus 1 squared n choose k plus 2 squared. And guess what? The only solutions are n equals 62 and k is 26 and 34. So there's a genuine solution. Here's how I did it. Suppose I look at my equation and I just simplify it. I just look at it and I simplify it and here's what I get. I get this ugly thing. The nice thing in this ugly thing is that so I can give names to variables like n minus k can be x and k plus 1 can be y. The nice thing about it is that this number in here is the only factor that's not square. That is a square, that is a square, that is a square. Therefore, I get that x squared plus y squared is a square. And now, I can use the known form of the Pythagorean triple. I know what x squared plus y squared equal a square means. It means that x equal twice times the product of some of two numbers, and y equal the difference of their squares, and the last one is the sum of their squares. So there's two cases. X is d times 2uv, and y is d times u squared minus v squared, with GCD of uv equal 1, and u not equal to v mod 2. And if I insert this one into this, see, sometimes you just have to be bold, of course. It doesn't look like it's going to lead you to anywhere, but you say, well, why not? Let's put them in there. You put them in there, you chase off the squares, and then you say, this number, u and v are co-prime and incongruent mod 2, this number is co-prime to that number. But here I have a product of these two guys equal to the product of these two guys. Since these two are co-prime, this means that this guy should divide into there, and that guy should divide into there. There's no other way. So, I get that 2duv minus 1 divided by u squared plus v squared, it's equal to du squared minus v squared plus 1 divided by 2uv, and it's some integer, which I'm going to call it d1. Perfect. I started with an equation and I got two equations. So I'm more rich now. I have an extra variable, but I have an extra equation as well. So I multiply them across and I rewrite them. The interesting things are u and v. I don't know what to say about them. The non-interesting things are d and d1 because the system is linear in d and d1. But I know what to do with linear systems. I will solve them with Cramer's rule. So let's solve them. And I get these expressions. But d and d1 have to be integers. Therefore, whatever sits in the bottom has to divide this top and has to divide that top. But you make some little argument here that this number and that number are basically co-prime. So if the bottom divides both this number and that number, then the bottom has to be 1. So you get this one. And you say, oh, okay, so what's the big deal about it? You've got something which is so bad looking. I say, well, yes, but I can regroup it in this way. Now, if I regroup it in this way, where do I know this? X squared minus 5y squared is plus minus 4. What does this remind you of? The cosine squared plus sine squared equal 1. Well, there's a theorem. Not only that it says that L sub n squared minus 5f sub n squared is always plus minus 4, but that if x and y are positive integers such that this is true, then the pair xy is the Luca Fibonacci number for some t. That's a theorem. You can use that theorem. So then you say, aha, I go back here, and then I get, okay, so then I get a Fibonacci number which is twice times the square. So how did this come up with the problem of finding consecutive binomial coefficients that form a Pythagorean triple? And then you go back and you chase down your solution and get in case 6226. And there's another case where these guys are switched. So this 2uv comes here and that one comes there because you see the equation is not really symmetric. So you have to see what that case gives you. But basically, you chase it around, and you get again to some question about a Fibonacci number being a square. All right, and whoa, thank you.
Are there any questions for Professor Luca?
Yes. Ah, that's a good question. I don't know. I know what practical numbers are. They are numbers that are sums such that every number between one and that number is the sum of divisors, right? Listen, I don't know the answer, but if I were to have a hunch, I will say that they are never. Because I think there's a theorem that says that if a number is practical if and only if, once you list out its prime factor, I believe each one of them has to be smaller than the product of the preceding ones or something like that. Isn't there a characterization like that? Yeah, but I think that will not be true for Fibonacci numbers. I would think, I have no idea how to prove things like this, but I would think the Fibonacci numbers, if they have small primes, they have small primes because you put them in there. Like if the index is a multiple of 3, then it's divisible by 2. And if it's a multiple of 5, it's divisible by 5. But after that, it's going to have huge gaps. So I know the Fibonacci community will be unhappy with my statement, but I think they are impractical.
Okay. Are there any other questions? I also want to thank Professor Luca once more.
Thank you.
And now I have some questions.